the issues affecting you. Revealed, explained, discussed. Now on WGAL 8 In Focus.
Hello, I'm Susan Shapiro. The Pennsylvania Interscholastic Athletic Association, or PIAA, has approved a policy for high school student athletes to profit from their name, image, and likeness.
I think it's tremendous for these student athletes to have that opportunity to make money off of their athletic ability.
The NIL policy allows student athletes to get commercial endorsements and earn money from promotional activities, including on social media, and even hold camps and clinics. Rodney Gallagher of Western Pennsylvania was the first in Pennsylvania, tweeting, "I signed an NIL deal."
It'd be tough to kind of try to find a balance between managing that kind of responsibility financially and just not taking away the, like I said, the hunger that the kids have to play the game.
Tonight, we talk with the executive director of the PIAA, an athletic director from Penn Manor in Lancaster County, who's also a parent of student athletes, as we put the name, image, likeness policy in focus. I'm joined now by Bob Lombardi, the executive director of the PIAA. Thanks for being here.
Thank you for the invitation and having us.
Mr. Lombardi, what do we mean by a name, image, and likeness policy?
Well, a name, image, and likeness policy is the student being able to control the use of their name, their image, or their likeness in any type of business-type ventures or promotional-type activities that would involve them.
Why did the PIAA choose now to approve this?
Well, this started about a year and a half ago with the Supreme Court decision with the NCAA, and we, along with another 22 states, are trying to get in front of this and be proactive. It's very, it's new water, so to speak, but we wanted to get in front of it so student athletes, as they go on to the next level or at the local level where we are today, don't make mistakes and cost themselves eligibility because they violate amateur status rules.
There are some restrictions to the policy, aren't there?
Well, we have seven no-nos. Students cannot promote activities such as alcohol products, casinos, gambling, tobacco and electronic products, opioids, controlled substances, pharmaceuticals, weapons, firearms, ammunition, adult entertainment items. They're the seven no-nos. And also, the student, if they do enter into an agreement, they must inform their principal or athletic director within 72 hours of signing such an agreement, so everybody is informed.
How widespread do you think this will be, that student athletes will be able to make some kind of agreement with any kind of company? Obviously, there aren't that many elite high school athletes out there. What do you expect?
This will be for the elite of the elite, and I think it'll be a handful at the most. This isn't going to be widespread. The biggest misinterpretation out there is the fact that this is pay for play. It is not pay for play. You can't entice a student to go from one school to another and offer them cash consideration or anything of the like. That is still a violation. So we think this will be very narrow in scope.
But do you worry that maybe parents would, get on a coach? My kid deserves to have some sort of contract. Is there concern about that kind of thing?
There's all sorts of tentacles to this, and some of it is unknown. But we feel with the foundation we have set with adopting this policy, that's phase one. We're going to move into phase two, and hopefully we will sign on with a educational provider that knows the ins and out of NIL, and they could be our go-to group so that moms and dads and schools and families can go to and get their expertise to lead them through these uncharted waters.
Is there any concern about alienating other team members should one student, sign some sort of contract?
I don't see that any different than regular coaching activities that a coach has to deal with. So there's always the haves and have-nots on a team. The coach has to deal with multiple personalities, also parental influence or pressure, community influence and pressure. The coach has a lot to do with. They have a lot on their plate. I'm sure this may add another little wrinkle, but our coaches in our state are outstanding. We have ultimate confidence in them.
Yeah, I was thinking about that. Does this give added pressure to coaches?
I'm sure it will.
Does this take away from what we know about what high school athletics is all about, building character, learning what it's like to be on a team? Do you worry that maybe we're getting away from that?
No, I don't think those things go away. Those lessons of the extension of the classroom that athletics provide, of teamwork, discipline, dedication to a goal, setting of a goal, cooperation, respect of your fellow teammates, ideals of good sportsmanship, they're never going to go away. But what this does is this allows the student that has the ability to do something to help their family to be able to do it. It's no different than the flutist or the cellist that has the opportunity to go to Carnegie Hall and participate and be funded for that. These students would then have the same opportunity. So that's a good thing.
Well, let's hope it all works out like that. Thanks so much for being here. Coming up on WGAL 8 in Focus, an athletic director in the Susquehanna Valley and a parent of student athletes says he doesn't think this is as big a deal as people may think.
This is WGAL 8 in Focus, coverage you can count on.
I'm joined now by Pat Tosse, who's the athletic director for the Penn Manor Area School District and a father to student athletes. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you. I look forward to talking to you.
You're new to this job, but you have experience in high school and college athletics, correct?
That is correct. Before I started at Penn Manor, I was with a group called the National Wrestling Coaches Association for over 20 years, where I worked with high school and colleges, along with the collegiate governing bodies such as the NCAA, the National High School Federation, state associations such as the PIAA, the New Jersey State High School Athletic Association, and then worked primarily with coaches, you know, at the high school and college level.
Did you have any experience with NIL?
So when I was finishing up at the National Wrestling Coaches Association, you know, the NIL really had started at the college. So you started working with it and hearing a lot about how the process would work at the collegiate level. So now that I moved to the high school level, you know, you're seeing how that went from college now to the high school level. So I did have a little bit of experience, not a lot, but enough to be knowledgeable on it from the collegiate level.
What was your reaction to hearing that the PIAA passed this policy?
I think it's a good thing. What I really like about it is it puts in some guidelines and guardrails, and it gives people basically a roadmap to how to follow the NIL policy. I think it's a good thing for student athletes. If they can have that opportunity to benefit, why not? But what I like is the PIAA put in some pretty good, I think, rules and guidelines to help guide schools, athletes, and everyone involved.
What do you think is important about the guidelines they did put in? What strikes you?
One, I think, is there's no collectives. I think the other one is how the school cannot be involved with helping negotiate or, you know, bring together some type of a deal for student athletes. And hopefully with those type of things, it would restrict this concern or perception out there that this is going to become like a pay-for-play policy.
We're hearing that term quite a lot. We heard that from the PIAA as well. What do you mean when we hear that term, pay for play?
So essentially is that you have people that are enticing a student athlete to transfer to another school through these like NIL deals or endorsements, I guess best way to put it, to come to their school and transfer them and then be able to participate as a student athlete.
Do you expect that many student athletes at the high school level will be approached for these NIL deals?
I think what we're seeing, you know, from what I understand is California had this in place since, I think, the mid 2000s. I think there's going to be little deals out there. I don't think there's this idea that every student athlete's going to be making big deals or getting all these NIL things. I think there'll be some schools, there'll be a handful that will get some NIL deals, but it's not going to be to the range I believe a lot of people think it will be.
Yeah, you don't expect Nike or any big corporations to be endorsing a lot of high school athletes.
Right. I think what you'll see is the local pizza place or someone like that that will come and approach a student athlete to do something, but you're not going to see these mega NIL deals.
In fact, the first student in Pennsylvania apparently who to make a deal was with a local paving company in Laurel Highlands out in the western part of the state. Is that what you kind of are alluding to?
Yes, I am.
All right.
You know, I think it's nice, you know, like within a local community, if they want to support a student athlete, I think it's good. I think what I also like with it is that for these student athletes and how I think it helps protect both the schools, the PIAA, is that, you know, they're not able to use their school, you know, uniforms. They're not allowed to reference the school. They're not allowed to reference the PIAA. So it's really their benefit simply off their name, image, and likeness.
All right, well, stay with us and we'll talk more about your role as a parent to student athletes.
This is WGAL 8 In Focus, coverage you can count on.
We continue our conversation with Pat Tosi, who's the athletic director for the Penn Manor School District and a father to student athletes. You said you have three athletes in your family, Coach?
I do. I have a son that's a senior at Millersville, where he's a wrestler. My middle son, Nico, is out at the Air Force Academy, where he's a wrestler. And then my youngest son, Marco, is a senior at Warwick. And he actually just signed with the University of North Carolina to wrestle for the Tar Heels next year.
Now, would you recommend an NIL deal for him or for your other children?
Yeah, I think it would be great if they would get that opportunity to, you know, do an NIL deal. I think he joked when it first came out, my son Marco was like, hey, I can go try to get an NIL deal. And I'm like, sure, great. You know, I think it would be great for him to be able to do something and be able to use his name, image, and likeness if there was a company or someone within our community that wanted to use him.
Do you worry that parents might be coming to the coaches and saying, my child deserves this, you should go for this, any kind of pressure like that?
I think what the nice thing with this is, again, where the PIA helped protect the coaches, the schools, is that there's really strict restrictions that the coach and the school cannot do that. So it's simply on the student athlete to go out and do that with, you know, within their community or within the people they know to get those NIL deals.
Certainly, we've heard a lot about aggressive parents on the sidelines of lots of games. I'm sure you've experienced that kind of thing. How do you deal with that?
Well, again, I think at least with this NIL, if we're talking from the NIL deal, I think it's really simple. It goes right back to the rules. If you're concerned about your son or daughter being eligible, well, then we can't be involved with this type of a deal. If you want to do it, great, all of the power to you. Why not, if you make money or get pizza or get whatever it may be, some type of a reward for your NIL, you know, using your name and image, go out and get it. But again, it comes back to, fortunately, the PIA put in some really good rules that help protect the schools in that regard.
What do you think are the downsides, possibly, of being so visible for a young person, a student athlete?
No, I think that's a really good question. And it's something I've definitely had thought about. I think it puts some additional, obviously, I think it puts additional pressure on that student athlete. From a competitor standpoint. And that's something, I mean, that's tough. You know, these student athletes are already under a lot of pressure to perform at a high level. And now you're putting their name out there and they're being much more visible within, maybe within their communities and outwardly on the social media through businesses. I think it just, again, puts a little more pressure on them to perform.
And do you worry that it could cause some, you know, additional competition between athletes? If one gets a deal and another doesn't on a team?
I think that's something you'd have to be a little bit concerned about. I think that's it's a fair point to make. Probably one I didn't really think about. I'm not sure how that would play out. So that's kind of an interesting one that you brought up there, and I don't have a great answer for it right this moment.
Neither do I. That's okay. What about, does this take away from the idea of especially high school sports being all about teamwork and about building character, which I'm sure is something you try to do? Do you think this takes away from that in any way?
I don't think so at all. And I speak again from the standpoint of from a parent's perspective, a former coach perspective, and now as an administrator. I try to look at this again from the positive side. I think you're still doing all the good things within your team. You're still building that teamwork. And again, what athlete is being able to go out there and do this on their, essentially doing it on their own and not being able to theoretically tie it back to the school.
Well, Coach, thank you so much. We appreciate you being here. Coming up on WGAL 8 in Focus, the owner of a business that helps student athletes with the NIL policy. She talks about what parents and athletes should know and the challenges they face.
This is WGAL 8 in Focus, coverage you can count on.
A business called Advance will be helping the PIAA get athletes and schools ready for NIL. Courtney Altimus is Advance's managing partner and founder and joins us now. Thanks for being here.
Thank you so much for having me.
What will your company's role be in this kind of thing?
We will be helping anybody and everybody in the state of Pennsylvania who needs it when it comes to name, image, and likeness. Everybody from heads of districts to ADs to coaches to families.
Why do you think they need training or help with this?
Well, I know they do after years of working with professional athletes from that transition from when they could not earn money on their name, image, and likeness to when they could. I know all of the challenges they face, and we've been working at the collegiate level for the last year and a half since they've been able to earn money. And from pro to freshman in college, they don't know because they haven't been trained. They don't know what they don't know. So at the high school level, they know less. And a lot of families don't know what to expect or what to look for in this space.
What are some of the challenges?
Some of the challenges are anything from time management, you know, not being able to balance school work and doing deals, all the way up to more scary ones, signing contracts with words like perpetuity in them, or signing away rights to terminate a contract. There have been situations where marketing reps have come in at the collegiate level and basically stolen from student athletes. So all of those horror stories of predatory practices in the financial world and in the legal world on professional athletes can happen at this level. We just really want families, students, coaches, ADs, district presidents, everybody to learn how to protect themselves.
What kind of money are we talking about that might be available to high school athletes, and what kind of deals?
Well, I think if this tracks at high school the way it did in college, we will see a small percentage of student athletes make these splashy 6- and 7-figure deals. Mostly elite athletes because they're household names, but sometimes athletes who are not household names but make themselves a household name through something other than their sport. So we can never know exactly where the big numbers are going to come from. But the majority, especially at the high school level, will be potentially representing local businesses, hopefully doing a lot of camps and clinics, working with younger athletes who look up to these high school superstars, really hoping that these high school students can use this as a way to start practicing for the rest of their life.
How do you think they could get in trouble?
Oh, a lot of different ways, unfortunately. I mean, the good news at the high school level is most, if not all, are minors, so their parents will have to sign on their behalf. And that's one layer of protection. And of course, the parents and guardians are the first and best layer of protection because they know their student athletes well. The companies, the people that have come out of the woodwork since name, image, and likeness started, who are just looking to make money off of these deals, are at a minimum, not looking out for these student athletes' best interests. And some of them are just downright fraudsters. So they have to be careful about everything from, you know, what they are wearing in their posts. They can't use marks and logos, to making sure that this, you know, outfit that wants them to post on social media is legitimate. Some marketing reps are coming in and saying, pay me X, I'll find deals. Mm-hmm. Nobody should be paying anybody anything. The only person that should be getting money is the student athlete. They don't know what industry standard fees are. We've seen some collegiate athletes paying 40% to marketing reps when industry standard is 20%. There's just a lot of different ways that they can be unprotected. And then getting some money in their pocket if they don't know how to save, how to make decisions around spending, and the fact that they're acting as independent contractors, so they have to put away money for taxes, and they will owe taxes.
Oh, that's an interesting point. So what would you advise a parent or student athlete if they do get approached by a business or a company?
Slow down. Anybody who is trying to rush you is a red flag, because there's nothing more important than what your child or student athlete is doing in their lives besides school, sport, family. And then I would immediately ask the person who has approached them for whatever they're saying in writing. Say, oh, that sounds great. Let me see it in writing. Could be an email. It doesn't have to be a contract. Look it over. If it's something that feels like you want to pursue or your student athlete wants to pursue, next step is to go to Coach and AD, and we'll also have on our app all of the Pennsylvania language to make sure that you're not going to interfere with playing eligibility.
Hmm. So each state has different language, I presume.
Yes, yes. So, and then after that, you want to make sure that you come to the app, get educated on what you should be looking for in terms of due diligence on a person, on a company, what pieces of the contract are really important to look at, and whatever other help you need, knowing going in what you're going to be compensated for, how you're going to be compensated. Is it going to be cash? Is it going to be merchandise? Is it going to be meals? And appropriately setting aside money for taxes for those things.
Mm, important information. Thanks so much for joining us. Thank you for joining us for WGAL 8 in Focus. For all of us at WGAL, I'm Susan Shapiro. And join us again next Saturday night at 7 o'clock for WGAL 8 in Focus, right after NBC Nightly News. And you can watch every episode of In Focus, plus WGAL's latest newscasts, original programming, and more. Just download the Very Local app and stream for free on Roku and Amazon Fire TV.